I must admit, I'm at a bit of a quandary when it comes to you. On one hand, I despise slavery. On the other hand, I need your help. If you're not in a position to refuse, all the better. So for the time being, I'm going to make this slavery malarkey work to my benefit. Still, having said that, I feel guilty.
I'm Garrett McQueen.
I'm Scott Blankenship.
And this is Trilloquy, Scott, the so-called classical music podcast. That's what I kind of came up with last time.
With finger flexion quotes?
Yeah, yeah, whatever whatever we want to do with that. We're going to get a good tagline in there, but I don't know. I'm kind of liking the whatever I'm feeling
one,
that day.
A new one every week.
Yep. So shout out to all of our returning listeners. Thank you so much. I've really, you know, y'all have really been making me feel great with everything that has been circling the internet and all the feedback y'all are giving us. Thank you so much. Welcome to the first time listeners. This is an interesting little show here, so I hope you enjoy whatever this is.
There is no turning back at this point.
Before we get into our first movement, just a couple of other announcements and shout outs. Thank you to Jenna Ross for the feature in the Star Tribune, Classical Agitator in big bold letters. That was something to see. So I guess, yeah, there's really no turning back now. It's in print. and then also shout out to Colleen Phelps down in Nashville at 91 Classical for putting together a nice feature of both of us. I thought it was really great. And you can check that out on their website. I'll be sure to link that in the description. And I want to shout out Nathan from Denver. I get so much feedback. I try to find someone to say hello to at the beginning of every Opus. So hello to Nathan. He said he's going to be coming through the Twin Cities this time next year as a composer. We'll be here for some things. So Nathan, I hope you bring us some weed because I love to smoke weed. Okay, anyway, so you ready? Do you have any announcements or shall we proceed?
Let's go.
All right, movement one, time for us to check our accidentals here. So I want to start, Scott, by throwing out a big natural to everyone listening. I was expecting a lot of upset people concerning the Louis Farrakhan opus.
I was getting nervous because you were nervous.
Yeah. There were some notes. There were some people with some responses, but all in all, I think people were really supportive and really open to what we were talking about. So I just wanted to throw a natural out there. I was anticipating something more than what it was. So yeah.
What in your mind would have been the worst case scenario?
The worst case scenario would be some viral thing happening on the internet talking about, Trilloquy is an anti-Semitic podcast and, you know, trying to cancel us, which we're actually talking about a little bit today, right?
I was about to ask you, was being canceled at all a concern?
Well, I think being canceled is always a concern, and you don't even have to be on social media for that. I mean, imagine if...
Well, clearly not.
Yeah, if something got around on the internet long enough about you and you're not particularly plugged into social media, not even on Facebook, it would still have an impact on you now, wouldn't it?
Probably. Yeah. And too bad I wouldn't be online to see it.
Oh, okay. Don't laugh because you never know.
That's true.
Okay. I decided to do a natural for this as well because I wasn't sure what my response should be. Kanye for president. You voting for him, Scott?
No.
Why not? Why aren't you voting for Kanye?
Because I want a serious candidate.
Well, what makes him not a serious candidate?
I don't think that somebody comes in 4 months beforehand and goes, yeah, I'm going to be president. I changed my mind. Now I want to be president.
I mean, but look at the situation. And this is not a politics podcast.
No, I'm much more interested in whether or not you're voting for him.
I mean, I think it's worth a conversation. That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying I'm voting for Kanye at all.
So let's have that conversation.
Okay. Right now we have a celebrity in chief. Mm-hmm. And Kanye seemingly would be a celebrity in chief that is thinking about me more than Donald Trump is right now. So what?
Great.
I mean, I'm not saying, look, I'm not, I'm not saying, I don't, folks are going to think I'm really crazy for even considering this. I mean, look, I think everything is sort of worth a conversation. So what would a Kanye West president, well, first and foremost, he's going to get some votes. Now that we don't even have to argue about that. So whose votes are he splitting? Is he taken away, or, you know, and what ways do you think a Kanye West run is going to impact the election if it ends up happening?
I think that the simplest, most base description of it is he would do that in order to take black votes away from Joe Biden. And if anybody out there thinks that that would actually work, then I don't know what to say to you. I wouldn't know what to say to a person who thinks that just because he's black means that that's going to mean that he's going to pull all of the black votes away.
I mean, and I think that we've already seen, and a lot of people would agree that Kanye is kind of on that sick and shut in list. You know, like we acknowledge the musical genius he is, but we also understand that everything isn't quite wound up correctly. some of those bolts need a little bit tightening. I don't know, however you want to put it. So I don't know if Kanye West would seriously take away from the existing black vote as much as he would, I think, get a couple people to go out and vote for him just to say they did.
Sure, but at the same time, anybody who thinks that is going to, you know, that people are going to do it just because he's black, and I'm telling you that's the conversation that's happening in the conservative circles. I've seen it.
So in the conservative circles, they're saying because Kanye West is black, he's going to pull the black.
The headlines are something along the lines of, you know, Biden campaign nervous with rumblings of, and you know, what, it's from Real Clear Politics or Daily Stormer or something like that. And yeah, that's all made up.
And you know, for folks who have been listening to Trilloquy for a while, Kanye West is a composer who has who has come up on the podcast before. I think when we did like a Christmas opus or something, we brought up a couple of his Christmas tunes.
No, there was Black Diamonds was the one that we excerpted.
Oh, wait. So it was Diamonds from Sierra Leone. And also the Christmas tunes, but because remember Christmas in Harlem or whatever it was, or but see that Diamonds from Sierra Leone is a really important song to me because, and we talk about him running for president, you know, that Kanye was really conscious and really paying attention to you know, the world as it related to race, and in that song he really affirmed that this jewelry, you know, that all these folks with money and access, you know, have blood all over them. A really interesting song. And in the end of the music video, he's playing two harpsichords at one time. I just remembered that.
You know, there are people out there who don't even have one harpsichord.
I know, and Kanye West is just banging away on two.
I think it's beating me over the head with it, really. I think he's showing off.
Well, anyway, Kanye 2020, I suppose, for those of you who...
All I'm saying is that I saw the video from when he went to the Oval Office for that meeting, and no, I'm not voting for him.
And nobody's mad at you for it, okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
All right, so I have one more little accidental, but I know you had, there was a cancel culture article that made it across your desk.
J.K. Rowling and, what, 149 other, how has the speech been going, entitled rich white people.
Not all of them are white now.
No, not all of them are white. And in fact, some of them even have fatwas against them.
Okay.
And so some academics and artists and writers have come together to bemoan the growing cancel culture.
Yes.
Go ahead. Have you got it pulled up?
Yeah, so this came out in Harper's Magazine on July 7th. Is there one byline? I mean, I know there are all these celebrities and stuff who signed
off
on it.
And everybody's got their own version on it, so take your pick.
Okay, well, and for folks who have yet to read this or don't even know about this, how would you sum it up?
It's basically what I interpreted it was there are some people who are taking the attack on free marketplace of ideas and applying that to art and music and words, and our warning of a pendulum swinging in the opposite direction of dogma becoming something that guides what we read and listen to and think.
So, I mean, basically, it sounds like what they're saying is, well, don't completely cancel the other side, because we're erasing discourse and argument and debate and all that in the process. My thing is, by acknowledging the validity, I don't think some of the things that I oppose deserve to be validated. I mean, especially when we're talking about being an anti-racist, anti-racism work, mm-hmm. racism does not deserve a place of validation in my book. I don't see what's wrong with canceling out those
right.
those ideals and some of those individuals the best we can.
I agree. Hate speech should be taken out. But
right.
I don't think that just because somebody has an opposing viewpoint and they are able to make an argument for it, I don't think that they need to be silenced.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we can apply this to radio formats. Let's talk about country music formats and the new country, right? What is country music associated with for you?
I mean, like I said, and what we're going to get into in the second movement, as soon as I hear that slide guitar, mm-hmm. I feel like I'm somewhere I don't belong. Okay. I need to walk right back out the door.
Right. Okay.
Get in my car.
Or, you know, boots and pickup trucks and good old boys.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah. Maybe I'm sure there's a Confederate flag somewhere.
Okay. Now that's where I'm interested in getting to.
Okay.
Because that doesn't make it into the videos.
Yeah.
But it is in the fabric.
Yeah.
That
in the
that
culture
some,
of
right
it.
That some people will assume that because you're listening to I'm not even familiar enough with country music to name an artist that would be current
these days.
So,
yeah,
right. So let's just say Travis Tritt, sorry. let's just say that you're listening to some country music, right?
Yeah.
How many steps away are you from the racism and white supremacy?
I mean, not many. It wouldn't seem like to me.
Just right. Okay, just by assumption.
Yeah.
Right? But the thing is that there are plenty of country artists out there who aren't racist.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we talked about one of them last time, didn't
sure,
we? Time
sure, sure. And so my point is, great, you've got however many radio stations that play that, and you have country music videos, whatever channel that is.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's an outlet for it, and you got to go find it. And I think that's fine. It's when it's hate speech and, you know, hurting minors and things like that. You got to squash that.
Yeah.
You got to squash that.
Yeah, there's no place on the other side. So, I mean, and let's try to give some of these folks the benefit of the doubt. When they talk about not completely canceling out the other side for the sake of discourse, what do you think is a fair example of, specifically when it comes to DEI work, you know, mm-hmm. racial equity and all that, what is something on the other side of the argument that you think deserves a place, even though you don't necessarily agree or think it's the
other side of the argument on this article that came out, this
because,
this open letter?
Well, yeah, because think about what they're saying. They're like, well, you know, we're turning certain things
right.
into dogma, so
right.
we can't erase the discourse. Well, what is this hyperbolic, or not hyperbolic, but this, you know, whatever discourse that they're thinking of that you think should be there, you know? I mean, I can't even really think of an example.
I think that one of the things that they were really trying to point out is that we can't get into a situation where anything that even minutely differs from this new progressive norm needs to be shut down, meaning that if you're not 100% behind whatever the group has said is what we're about, if you dissent with that, then you're canceled, then you're done.
Right. I just don't understand what is being protected. So in this open letter, you know, they're saying we're turning one side of the argument into a dogma, and if you don't agree with it, you're erased.
You're shunned.
I mean, so what is the—
I don't know, maybe—
What is the other side of it that we should be accepting? What I'm asking. What is being protected? What do we fear in getting rid of if, you know, certain certain things become truths, become ways we treat each other. It just becomes regular for racism not to be a thing. There's no argument. There's no discussion there. You know,
maybe J.K. Rowling thinks that she should be able to say negative things about trans people. Because that's what happened, right?
Yeah, over and over and over again. Well, Wynton Marsalis signed this.
And if you want to see just how divisive it is, there are some people that signed onto it and then went, oh, I shouldn't have signed on. And then Fox News jumps on that and they're holding those people up. The people who said, I'm sorry that I signed it.
But it seems like the more conservative side would be for this open letter as
right,
it exists.
Right, but it's a whole bunch of lefties or perceived lefties on the list.
Oh, so the ones who jumped out and and came back are, you goodness gracious, I don't have time for all that. Do you have anything else concerning this? I think people should read it and really think about it. But
there are good points to this letter, and I think that some of the first backlash that you're going to see is a bunch of people with entitlement want you to let them play however they want. But I would really encourage you to read some of the opinion pieces that respond to it.
I'm looking at this last sentence here. If we won't defend the very thing on which our work depends, we shouldn't expect the public or the state to defend it for us.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, as I think about that, as it applies to, you know, our work, even that, I think we should be able, I think it's our charge to critique this, you know, again, so-called classical music for what it is and the role that it's played and the things that, you know, we fight against. I don't think that means that the public won't defend classical music. I think they can be along with us in recognizing the shortcomings, acknowledging those things and applying that to how we traverse all of this in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, there'll be a link to that in the description. Just go take a look at that. But I have one more accidental before we get into the second movement. So it seems like this happened like right after we taped last week. But the band Lady Antebellum.
Oh, yes.
Okay. They, you know, since the great white awakening of racism in the country, they decided then that the name Lady Antebellum is a little insensitive. So they decided that they wanted to go by Lady A. Now, there was a woman who has been, you know, performing since, and she did an interview on CNN that I watched a few days ago, says she's been performing since 1987 over on the West Coast, I believe,
yep,
who goes by Lady A and has always gone by Lady A. So Lady Antebellum wanted to cut the word antebellum and go by Lady A.
Which, half golf clap.
Well, I mean, not even that, because y'all have decided now that antebellum is problematic.
Right, I'm getting to that part though. But you're joining up, so half
sure,
half uninspired clap.
Right, so yeah, so some of y'all are proud of them for that. Yes, woo woo woo, all that. So and you know, fast forward, you know, a little while, it turns out that Lady A from, you know, the West Coast, this black who I would call a blues singer, I think she describes herself like in that way, wants $10 million from them, and people are like, oh, that's ridiculous, da da da. And then Lady Antebellum, the band, has to announce that unfortunately this is going to have to go to court so they can use Lady A. So in her interview on CNN, Lady A, she talked about how there were talks of them both using the name, but what she said they don't understand is that as a band, they are this big entity and she is just a singer. So if they take the name Lady A as well, when you Google them, when you look them up,
you
have
find,
all of them and not her. And, you know, even earlier I was looking up a tune and that was the case on YouTube. I mean, I could Google Lady A now and kind of prove the point she's making.
Yeah, you see her show up with the band only because it's in news stories.
Right.
That's it. So as soon as that falls off the news cycle, Lady A will not be showing up in your Google searches.
Right. So why this is important, why this is a poignant moment, I think You know, when we talk about, again, this cancel culture, we just got done talking about this open letter. You know, this is another sort of canceling, a sort of erasing that is born from, you know, these power structures that run along the lines of racism. Now, you can say all day that, oh, Lady Antebellum isn't racist and they changed her name and it's just unfortunate that this happened and whatever. You know, you can say all of that. But at the end of the day, you have these singers, these white singers with, excuse me, all this money and all this access, and then you have, you know, this individual woman who's been doing it since before, almost before they were born.
Who's been grinding it out.
You know, and then, and yet, you know, the band has the final say and all that sort of thing.
I'm going to bring up a Reinhold Gleyre reference.
Okay.
Okay, because
the composer.
Right, Reinhold Gleyre comes out with a new piece of music that he hasn't been heard from in a couple years. And the response in town by people was, Gleyre's alive? Okay, so
yeah.
For somebody who does not listen to country radio, I didn't even know that Lady Antebellum was still around.
And I'm sure maybe they've had some hits since the 90s. Or
And I'm looking, since the 90s, they were formed in 2006.
Oh, wow. So you thought they were a 90s band?
No. No, what I'm saying is I thought they were already gone from the scene.
Oh,
I thought they
okay.
had already. I thought they had already had their flash in the pan. And hey, if you're still making records and you're still getting people to come out and see your shows, more power to you. The problem is that a woman who has been doing this before you, I think is due if she's due something. If you're going to take the fact that you've got a recording house behind you and a contract and a marketing budget, and if you're still recording and doing shows and all of a sudden taking all the oxygen out of the Google searches to find Lady A, then yeah, I think that you should give her a couple bucks if you're going to go by Lady A.
And personally, I think 10 million is a nice round number. I think that would be perfect. So if you're asking me, that's what I say as well. And I'm actually going to bring this back up a little bit in the fourth movement today. So I think we'll go ahead and give it a rest there. And we can go ahead and transition into our second movement, talk about what music struck a chord this week as we listen to a little bit of music by the real
Lady A.
And you know, I scroll through a few things, and I think this song is kind of poignant. You know, it's called Doin' Fine. And, you know, after all this is done, I'm sure Lady A is dealing with headache right now, wherever, you know, she is. But all in all, I think it's going to work out. I'm glad this story came out. And I'm glad that, you know, black folks are going to, you know, keep on going until we make sure that Lady A is doing just fine.
Because you ask me how I'm doing. Baby, I'm loving life and I'm doing fine.
Doing fine. Yes, I'm doing fine.
Okay, movement two, strike a chord. So, I'm going to let you go first. So you had some music you wanted to talk about this week. What about Keb Mo?
Keb Mo. Now, we had been on the Roots conversation recently, and I'm sure that in the record store, if you go to look for Keb Mo, they're going to put him under blues or Americana or whatever. But I think that there's some roots to it because he relies on his technique, which is impeccable on the guitar, and a voice that is just so powerful that, you know, he's got a lot of recordings with bands, but he's somebody that could go out and play a solo show and knock your socks off. The reason that I brought him up was because I'd been listening to him recently, thinking about how I got back to actually practicing guitar and taking lessons again. There is a certain song that he does called Every Morning, and there's an attack that he does with the slide that stuns me every time and makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up. There must be something among white people where if you stumble across a name that nobody else knows and it's different, that nobody, you know, that you feel like you're bringing it, Okay, so let's talk about the Christopher Columbus. What was it?
Christopher Columbus syndrome.
Yeah, okay. So I felt like I had discovered him.
And this is a black artist we have yet to mention.
Right, it's a black artist. And I felt like I was illuminating people to the genius or the bliss that was Keb Mo.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and as it turns out, he's a guy that's, you know, he was like a lot of blues artists. He gets on the circuit. He probably plays 300 nights a year.
Yeah.
And records when he gets back home and everything. But to me, it seems like he's really holding on to some tradition, that there is a sound that he's bringing out that is the opposite of the Lady Antebellums, the commercial country.
Right.
You know, it's the real music of people.
And when I listen to it, you know, what you showed me, I'm just reminded of just an earthy sort of music. Maybe that's why they use the term roots when they talk about it. It just seems just just natural.
Uncorrupted.
Yeah, uncorrupted. And then, you know, for me, you know, seeing a black artist, you know, do that is, it just opens up a new world for me completely, because that's not a world in which I, you know, ever knew or expected folks that look like me to be involved in. But
it's really interesting that, you know, you were talking about how recently you've been getting back to spirituals and you're not a religious person.
No.
And,
amen.
And yet they're, you know, like with some of these Americana, the four-part harmonies and stuff like that. I'm not a religious person either, and those things have me dropping to my knees and testifying, you know. And I think that there's something about Keb Mo's music that does that, that it rings inside me in a way that I can't adequately describe.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe I have a connection to this music in, you know, some past life. I don't know.
Yeah, it's something how, you know, music does that.
When
it's
done well.
The power of music.
Yeah. Done well.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, so, you know, we're talking about roots, and we're here doing our due diligence on try to seek the praises of that music. And I have really, Scott, been doing my best to get into some of this country, as I promised I would, you know, with an open mind. Several people got back to me following our conversation about country and roots from a couple weeks ago and saying that, you know, I need to look up Charlie Pride. You know, he's this black country singer who really shook up the game. So I've been listening to some Charlie Pride. And, you know, I told you before we cut the mics on, as soon as I hear that slide guitar, it's just, I just feel just in danger because of the culture that I have always had to attach to that music. And of course, I'm opening my mind up. And, you know, we pulled up Charlie Pride on Lawrence Welk, which was, you know, really cool to see. And we heard him sing this song, Between You and Me. And, you know, I think it just speaks to, you know, why so many songs are love songs, because like love, you know, the feelings of it are universal and really come out through music in a beautiful way. And I have to say that Charlie Pride song in particular is one that I've really started to appreciate.
So I feel so blue, sometimes I wanna die.
Now, of course, if we're going to talk about country music at all, I need to, you know, shout out, you know, East Tennessee, where I moved here from. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Dolly Parton is a patron saint there.
Of course she is.
To say the very least. And, you know, as I was listening to the Charlie Pride, that song in particular, I was reminded of a song that I had to learn for a virtual graduation ceremony a little while ago that I performed at. You know, 2020 is a weird year, but
right.
it was requested that I perform some rendition of Dolly Parton's light of a clear blue morning, you know. Mm. And I have to think now, because, you know, again, country is just a genre I don't know, but, you know, learning that song and hearing what Dolly is saying about, you know, just going through the night and struggling and finally getting that freedom, you know, amen, you know, as we were saying, you know, it just really strikes a chord with you, you know, just as this movement is titled.
I've been looking for the sunshine. You know, I ain't seen it in so long. But everything's gonna work out just fine. And everything's gonna be alright. It's been alright.
Do you know Crystal Gayle?
No.
I'm gonna play some Crystal Gayle.
Okay.
You're going to like this.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll play some Crystal Gayle for you, and we'll talk about it next week.
All right. Well, today's guest for the third movement is my dear friend, Cesar Chivetta. He lives in New York, is a Beethoven specialist and has studied all sorts of composers and maestros. He has a really great book out on Arturo Toscanini that I would recommend. Mm. But in some of his studies on a man named Pete Seeger, he discovered for himself the story of a man, named Paul Robeson. Mm. And, you know, Scott, the first time I heard Paul Robeson's name was Bill Morlock. You know, your friend Bill Morlock just in passing said something about him, you know, when we were talking about, you know, what we're doing on Trilloquy. And I wrote his name down and I kind of just forgot. But talking to Cesar, you know, he really woke me up to this man's, you know, story that was so important and that somehow blew by me. You know, just as we were talking about last week with Louis Farrakhan being a violinist, we have this black man who many consider one of the world's first celebrities, you know.
Period, black or otherwise.
Right, a champion football player, a great actor, I mean, a great looking man, you know, I should say. And then this incredible baritone who really used spirituals and songs from the working class in an effort to, you know, bring folks together and bring on this revolution that, you know, we're trying to talk about and edge toward today. So, Cesar and I just sort of sit and he tells me about what he's learned about Paul Robeson. And I've learned so much about him in the process. So I hope those of you listening will hang out to learn about him as well. But as we transition, who did you just say that you're going to let me listen to?
Crystal Gayle.
How about we listen to a little bit of Crystal Gayle to get us into this third
one? Oh, you know how to get me.
Take me home, you silly boy. Put your arms around me. Take me home.
Yeah, I went to the New York Public Library. I was a freshman in high school. I was 12, and they had a room called the Record Room, and it was just a room from floor to ceiling lined with bookcases filled with vinyl. And I didn't know what I was checking out. I just took one randomly off the shelf and checked it out and took it home, and it was Mozart's Sixth Symphony, Kershal 43.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And it just really turned me on. And my sister's boyfriend gave me a Christmas gift of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, a vinyl recording. So I used to listen to that all the time. And then the high school band director had been a substitute trumpet player in the NBC Symphony under Toscanini. So he used to regale us with stories about playing with Toscanini, and that kind of got my interest. I started reading about him. So that was it. I was studying piano, but I never wanted to be a pianist, so I never wanted to learn piano repertoire. So I fought with my piano teachers. I just wanted to do exercise, just get some technique, and then just be an ocean. and absorb chamber repertoire and leader and opera and symphonies. I just wanted to become a really good sight reader to digest all this music. So my pianistic skill stopped at a certain point as a teenager. They didn't develop from there.
I see. Do you feel like you're a decent sight reader these days?
Well, you know, I can learn my scores, and that's you know, so it's just a tool, but I refuse to play publicly.
Yeah. And you know, something else that I really find fascinating about you is that you have seen so much in the city of New York. These days, we talk a lot about folks who, you know, have moved there and found fame. But, you know, you're tried and true for, you know, many decades now as a New Yorker. How have you seen the arts landscape there sort of evolve over the years? You know, you mentioned the NBC Symphony. That's not a thing anymore, but there are lots of other groups sort of on the scene, right?
I think the biggest thing is maybe in the last few decades, there's just been an incredible blossoming of small opera companies, not just in New York, but all throughout the United States. And of course, regional orchestras and bigger orchestras that, for example, in 1967, when Robert Shaw took over the Atlanta Symphony, it was not a full-time orchestra. They had day jobs. They rehearsed in the evening. And by the time he left 21 years later, they had a $20 million annual budget, you know, back in the 80s.
Yeah.
So a lot of orchestras have become full-time, 52-week seasons. And there's just a lot more orchestras and a lot more opera companies. This notion that classical music is dead or it's dying or it's is ridiculous.
You know, you're mentioning opera actually serves as a really great segue into the next question I wanted to ask you. You know, we're talking about Paul Robeson today, and you can't talk about Robeson without talking about race and the implications of that conversation in classical music. How do you think the way we see race when it comes to folks like Leontine Price, you know, Marian Anderson, Paul Robeson, who we'll talk about, how do you see that conversation having evolved over the years, really including the idea and the challenges of race in two conversations about this art form?
Well, when you say race, we have to then insert the word racism.
Sure.
Yeah. There's a wonderful baritone named Raymond Martin who sang, I think, a tour of Porgy and Bess with the Met years ago in their previous production, and sang many wonderful performances in Central Park with the New York Grand Opera and in Carnegie Hall, a lot of Verdi baritone roles. I'm using him as an example. And, you know, he's very dark, very dark. And the artistic director of the New York Grand Opera had commented, he kept hiring him. They worked beautifully together, and he sang many of the leading Verdi roles in the Verdi cycle of all his 28 operas they did in Central Park. But the conductor said, if only he weren't so dark, this has really affected how far he can go in his career.
Paul Robeson is the person that we're here to talk about today. And, you know, I looked at some of the information that you sent me and did some reading on my own. I was really shocked to learn that Ebony had named him among the top most important Black men in American history. You know, that's so incredible. Yet his is a name that so many people just don't know. I mean, why is Paul Robeson this figure that we should really hail as one of America's most important people?
Well, let's talk about some of the outstanding achievements. He was awarded the Spingarn Medal by the NAACP. Mm-hmm. He was awarded honorary doctorates from Rutgers, Hamilton, Morehouse, Howard. He was a graduate of Columbia Law School. He made many Hollywood movies that he starred in. He was hailed as a great Shakespearean actor playing the role of Othello here in the United States and especially in London. And so there were so many achievements. I mean, my goodness, there's a mountain named after him in Kazakhstan. There's a postage stamp that bears his image. There's four streets named after him in New York and New Jersey. And so the idea that he'd be erased from textbooks, from history books, is just mind-boggling. I know some young millennial friends that live here in Harlem that never heard of the name Paul Gibson.
Wow. And you know, one of his famous quotes was, you know, the artist must elect to fight for freedom or for slavery. And he, you know, he was very outspoken about what side of that, you know, he lived on and he worked on both in and outside of music. Would you consider that decision one that had an impact on, you know, the way that he isn't remembered among many communities, the fact that he was canceled, as folks say today, erased from history? Do you think that dedication to liberation and anti-racism played a role in that?
Well, I think we have to just consider who his biggest influence was, and it may have been Frederick Douglass.
Right.
He studied his writings and speeches meticulously and liked to quote him. And one quote that he repeated a lot was from Frederick Douglass, "If there is no struggle, there is no progress." But the thing about Robeson was he was so beloved all over the globe because he made 300 recordings. He was a movie star. And so these recordings and movies were enjoyed by people down under in New Zealand and Australia and throughout Russia and Eastern Asia and India and China and Europe. He was beloved all over the world. So he had an enormous platform. And once he decided to use it as an activist, It really drove the course of his life.
Yeah.
In fact, he announced at one point that he was retiring from, as he put it, commercial entertainment. And so he would only use his art from that moment on to further the causes that he dedicated his life to.
Yeah. Most famously, from my perspective anyway, through his role on Showboat and the way that, you know, he changed the lyrics and put his own spin on the song Old Man River. But before we get into that specifically, I want to talk a little bit about, you know, you mentioned his global impact. And, you know, if you listen to him sing, you can obviously hear his respect and dedication to the Negro spiritual, you know, that original American classical music. But it's not just that. There's a song that he performed called Joe Hill that I understand had, you know, such a huge impact on the conversation of the working class and how that sort of liberation was important, you know, in his perspective. What can you tell us about that song, Joe Hill, who Joe Hill was, and how Robeson used that as a tool in his fight for global liberation for the working class?
Joe Hill was a copper miner in Utah, and he was also a songwriter and an activist. And in 1915, he was executed. He had been framed on a murder charge and executed, and many people felt that he was innocent. And so this song about Joe Hill was a favorite of Robeson's, and he sang it throughout his career.
And I understand there's a specific part of it that you that really tickles your fancy, if I may use that phrase.
I never died, says he. I never died, says he.
Yeah, it really is such a beautiful song. And, you know, again, as I mentioned before, you know, the way Robeson used that song ended up having a global impact when it came to the working class and, you know, liberation for those folks. But what, you know, history has proven to be a bigger example of that, as I mentioned before, was his role on Showboat. What do you know about his role in that film?
You know, he used that song, Old Man River, was his staple. Mm-hmm. And there's footage of him singing it from the movie version of Showboat and many recordings of him in live concerts singing it. But the fascinating thing is that early on in his career, he changed some of the lyrics. Near the end, the original lyrics are, I'm tired of living and feared of dying. And he changed it to, I must keep fighting until I'm dying.
And what does that say to you, his decision to change the lyrics like that?
Well, he was a warrior. And especially this beautiful footage of one of the performances where when he gets to that point, and sings, I must keep fighting, and he shakes his fist in the air. It's extraordinary. He was an incredibly courageous guy. You know, being born in 1898, his father was a slave. He escaped when he was 13.
Right.
But his father was highly educated at Lincoln University. He had already been studying Hebrew in preparation for his career as a minister. And so as a boy, as a student, you know, his mother died when he was only five, and his elder siblings had left the home. So he was just raised by his father, and they had this very, very, very tight relationship. But his father was very, very strict. And one of the things he liked to do, not only to Paul, but to his siblings as well, was train them in the art of oratory. So when they had to recite something for school, his father would coach them at home, or he was always on the debate team in high school. He won the debate team all 4 years when he was at Rutgers. And so his father was an enormous influence. And for the rest of his life, he always would think to himself, how am I doing, Pops? And so his father instilled this incredible thirst for languages and knowledge. And the idea that he mastered over 20 languages is mind-boggling.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, he was the only Black student all 4 years that he was at Rutgers. And then he went on to Columbia Law School, but he didn't want to practice law because he saw the racism that was so prevalent in that field. And he didn't realize that he had this talent, that he had this incredible golden voice like honey. And he never thought that he could act. This was his wife Islanda, that he married when he was still in Columbia. She pushed him. And when she wrote his biography, she really wrote that he was lazy, and because he was so talented.
Yeah.
He didn't have that kind of discipline. She pushed and pushed and pushed him in those early years.
So, yeah. So what I guess what I'm hearing you saying is that in that role in the movie Showboat, you know, he felt this obligation to you know, use that platform to say what he needed to say, you know, to use those skills that his father taught him. And really prioritize to, you know, help people understand what the reality of this country was at that point.
One of the reasons he's my hero is because he did away with all the formalities of musical presentation and such. And he didn't just, first of all, he was the first person who did a concert that was comprised exclusively of what were called Negro spirituals.
Yeah.
Back in 1925. It had never been done before. And that proved to the world that this music should be taken seriously and that it was not inferior to European music. And so the idea of singing music that was of his heritage was crucial to him. And that's why he never sang opera. He refused to sing opera. He could have had an amazing career as an opera singer.
Oh, of course, yeah.
But he didn't feel any connection to that European heritage. So he only sang songs that were either Black secular songs or religious spiritual songs, or then especially songs of the working class.
Yeah.
And that was what drove him to study languages, because he ended up living in London early on for many years, because he was in plays. Eugene O'Neill was writing new plays for him, and he was giving concerts. He was touring. So he was based in London. And it was there that he began formally studying all these languages, you know, African languages and Chinese and Hebrew and Yiddish and Arabic. And it's just mind-boggling. But while there, he befriended other students that were from Africa that later became the presidents of Kenya and Ghana, and even Nehru, the prime minister of India. His friends.
He had some good company. Now, this, you know, this love and respect for, again, that very American art form, the Negro spiritual, it seems like in 2020, that would be something that, you know, America would celebrate, you know, being a light being shined on that abroad. But, you know, history shows that America didn't particularly have his best interests in mind or appreciated the work he was doing. I mean, I read that there were folks trying to get his name slandered in the Ghanaian newspapers. His passport was even taken away by the U.S. government for many years. I mean, what are your thoughts on that? You know, America's very violent response to the work that Paul Robeson was doing internationally and domestically.
Well, you know, the spirituals were an anchor for him. He would point out, he would speak from the stage. He never just gave a concert formally. He would speak in between the songs.
Okay.
And that's where he had this outlet for his activism throughout his career. But he would speak about the spirituals and point out that the spirituals helped the slaves prepare to escape to freedom, and that Harriet Tubman was identical to Moses, because she was an escaped slave and had returned to the South repeatedly to rescue others. Mm-hmm. And so he saw these very direct parallels from the stories in the Bible of the ancient Israelites to his own people in a contemporary 20th century at that time. So the spirituals were for him his anchor or his foundation.
And, you know, listening to him sing those spirituals, you can really just feel the emotion and the power behind, you know, what he was trying to say in between those songs at those concerts, as you've described. How about we listen to a little bit of Paul Robeson singing one of those spirituals here? So, of course, you know, in addition to, you know, Paul Robeson's legacy being one that folks of my generation, you know, weren't really exposed to on the same way that we were exposed to others. The same applies in my experience to the Vietnam War. And that's something that Paul Robeson, you know, quite openly had an opinion on. You know, I want to ask you, since, you know, you were there in that time, what were the implications of openly opposing the Vietnam War? What did that mean back in those days?
Way back in the 50s, before things heated up, we were sending tanks and planes to prepare for this war. And he was criticizing it then. And he thought, why should young Black soldiers from the United States be sent to shoot and kill people of color in Vietnam just because of the imperialistic tendencies of the United States, that they have raw materials that we want? The same thing with what was then called colonial Africa, the colonial countries of Africa. He created this organization in 1937. And was then the chairman of it. Was called the Council on African Affairs, and it was, its purpose was to help with the liberation of the colonial countries of Africa. And this was a real thorn in the United States government's side, because Great Britain and the United States were the imperialists, and the working peoples of the world were the vast majority, but were oppressed by the imperialists. And so his work on behalf of the indigenous peoples of Australia, for example, or of the colonial countries in Africa, was very much a part of his activism, just as much as the racism in the United States, which, by the way, he compared to Nazi fascism. Mm. He considered that the American politicians who allowed for racism and we have to discuss lynching, he compared to and characterized as being fascist.
So, you know, all of those things considered, and, you know, again, your being able to personally speak to being around, you know, when things were, you know, a little more, how can I say, a little more unrested than they are these days, you know, all of that considered, is it a surprise to you at all that Paul Robeson's legacy was kind of, you know, pushed to the side by this same American government?
It's such a tragic story. After World War II, the Black American soldiers who returned, many of whom lived in the South, were being lynched. 1946 alone, hundreds of them. And Robeson was able to have a meeting in the Oval Office of the White House with President Truman.
Oh, wow.
And he headed up a delegation and marched in there and demanded that President Truman instigate some kind of legislation in Congress that would make lynching a federal crime. Mm. And Truman refused. And Robeson warned him and said, look, there's just a limit to what my people are going to put up with. Whereupon Truman jumped up red in the face and shouted, that sounds like a threat. And he abruptly ended the meeting there. That was in 1946. Lynching is still not a federal crime.
And it's still happening in 2020. It's still happening.
There's a bill that an anti-lynching bill that passed the House of Representatives at the end of last year, the beginning of 2020. And then it was to be voted on in the Senate. And it was being promoted by Kamala Harris and Cory Booker. And it didn't pass. There was they weren't able to pass it. So it's still, as we speak in July of 2020, it's still not a federal crime.
You know, Paul Robeson died in 1976, and I think I'm remembering that the funeral took place in New York. Is that correct?
In Harlem.
In Harlem, yeah. What were you? Were you around? Were you aware of that event?
No, I never heard of Paul Robeson.
So what you know and what you've studied is all in sort of retrospect. You know, after the fact.
Yeah, I was working on a documentary on Pete Seeger, the father of American folk music.
Oh,
and,
okay.
And he had been asked by Robeson to sing at a concert in Peekskill, New York in 1949. There was this horrendous incident called the Trenton Six. Mm. And there were a group of six young black boys in New Jersey, in Trenton, who were accused of committing murder, of the murder of William Horner, and were sentenced to death. And so Robeson and Seeger gave this concert in Peekskill to raise money for the legal defense of this Trenton Six in 1949. And so I heard about Robeson just studying about Pete Seeger.
Oh, goodness. Wow. Isn't that incredible? Wow.
And then I think it was about a year and a half ago, I had a hernia operation. And during my recovery, I had ordered these books about Robeson. So I could just lay, I could hardly walk. I was just recuperating. And I started studying and I just became transfixed, you know, and I've just been immersed in his life and music for the last year and a half.
Wow. Maybe you've heard of a historian named Martin Duberman. I read some of his words and which, you know, he's talking about that funeral in 1976 and affirming that, you know, the lack of celebration is rooted in white America's inability to accept a black man who just wouldn't bend. And I felt like that was a really interesting way to frame it. You know, this man who just was not going to take it, you know, a man whose legacy that we just don't really know about as far as the way what we're taught in music school and our textbooks. You know, you yourself just said that, you know, you found out about him sort of in a sideway sort of way. Are we beginning to see that shift? Will music students, you know, of the next generation, do you see Paul Robeson being a part of what they understand to be the history of American classical music, you know, especially considering how impactful this individual was?
I said earlier that he's one of my heroes, but so is Louis Armstrong.
Yeah.
And so is Nelson Mandela.
Names we're a little more familiar with, right?
And so is Beethoven.
for the record.
But the thing about music is that it has always played such an important role in any kind of movement for justice, for social justice, whether it was anti-apartheid in South Africa when Mandela was in jail for 28 years, or the civil rights movement here. You can think of the anthem, We Shall Overcome. Mm-hmm. Robeson had come to this conclusion pretty early on, which is very interesting. His conviction was that the persecution of blacks was based on class more so than it being based on race. And his philosophy was, if there could be a united front of working class people, black and white, working class workers, that would be the key to eliminating the whole concept of white superiority, because the white employers historically would poison their white workers' minds in order to pit the white workers against the black workers. So by creating a unified front between all workers, blacks and white together, that would destroy the strategy of the industrialists, of the imperialists.
Wow. So let's apply that idea to today, 2020. You know, we've seen our country just kind of rocked by racial injustice. The coronavirus has really cut a lot of the working class off at the knees, you know, with the closing of so many businesses. You know, how can Robeson's dedication to that racial equity and to liberation of the working class, you know, how do you think, you know, his ideals can be turned into actionable items for today's society?
Well, back in 1946, he gave a speech in Madison Square Garden, and he stated that this whole notion at the time of stop Russia, this whole communist scare, the Red Scare, the Cold War, but this cry, stop Russia, meant stop progress, maintain the status quo. It means let the privileged few continue to rule and thrive at the expense of the masses, end quote. And when I read that sentence, that sounds just like Bernie Sanders, doesn't it?
The fight that we are waging is not an easy fight. But I know you are prepared to wage that fight against the 1%, against the billionaire class.
We have to talk about Russia. We have to talk about the Soviet Union. He went to Russia at the invitation of Eisenstein, the premier filmmaker in Russia, who wanted to do a film with Robeson about the Haitian Revolution. And that's why he went there, to meet with this filmmaker. They never made the film. But he was so blown away by what he encountered in Russia. No racism.
Sure.
He couldn't believe it. And there's this incredible quote that he repeated throughout his life where he said, for the first time, I feel like a real human being in Russia because of the absence of racism. And so much so that in the 30s, he enrolled his 9-year-old son in elementary school in Moscow. because he didn't want his boy to be subject to racism in the United States.
Wow. Wow.
And he didn't live in Moscow. His mother-in-law went to live with the grandson in Moscow while Robeson and his wife were always on a tour. They were always on the road. Their main headquarters was in London, and they'd come in and out of Moscow, but the boy was educated in elementary school in Moscow.
So let's go back to, you know, stop Russia. What was the relationship between those words and, you know, his love for this place that, you know, as you just laid out, treated him like he was a human being?
He was beloved in Russia. And during World War II, that was our ally. As soon as World War II was ended, that was our enemy.
Yeah.
And the Cold War started. And that's where he got into trouble, because he wouldn't speak against Stalin. He wouldn't speak out against Russia. He wouldn't play into that whole narrative about the Cold War. And so he was accused of being a communist. And there was this Smith Act passed, which meant if you were a member of the American Communist Party, you could be imprisoned for 10 years. So this whole series of hearings, Senate committee hearings, whereby a lot of artists were dragged in and asked point blank, are you a member of the Communist Party? Robeson refused to answer the question. He thought it was an unconstitutional question. Mm. And he sarcastically said, would you like to come with me when I vote? And you could read my ballot if you're so curious. But he stood on the Fifth Amendment and he wouldn't answer those kinds of questions. But he got himself into a lot of trouble. He was convinced that the whole idea of stop Russia, stop the communist scare, that was so that the United States and other imperialists could proceed without any obstacles. And he described what he was doing was not being a communist, it was being an anti-fascist. Mm. And he kept comparing the American governments and the American government policies to fascism, which just drove them crazy.
Right.
So as you alluded to earlier, in 1950, they forced him to surrender his passport because the State Department considered he was too dangerous. He was going around the world speaking out against the United States government and calling them fascists.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't have it. So for 8 years through the 50s, he was not allowed to leave the country. And even going to Mexico and Canada in those days didn't require showing a passport, but they told the border patrol, if he tries to cross the border, don't allow him to. And if he does, we'll put him in jail and for I think it was 5 years imprisonment and a $10,000 fine. So they kept him from leaving the country for 8 years. And they did more than that. Record stores were not allowed to sell his records. Radio stations couldn't play them. So he would do concert tours, but then venues, he could easily fill the largest concert venues. They wouldn't rent him the venues. And so then he went to black churches.
Yeah.
And he would go on tour around the country singing at black churches. And they stopped that too, because they went to the banks. And they had the banks tell the churches, if you allow Robeson to appear in your church, we will foreclose on your mortgage.
So it wasn't pedestrian. It was very active, the way in which the government was trying to quell what he was doing and what he was saying.
And he would get around it. He was supposed to sing in Vancouver. They wouldn't let him leave the country. So he came back 3 months later. And on the Washington State Canada border, they set up an amplification system. And he sang for thousands and thousands of people across the border that were gathered there to hear him. He did the same thing in Great Britain. He wasn't allowed to go. The Welsh miners have an annual song festival, and they wanted him to come. He wasn't allowed, so he sang through the brand new transatlantic cable that had just been laid. And he would try to find ways to get around it, but eventually the government did succeed in silencing him. And this brings up a fascinating subject about protesting today.
Right.
And if you don't mind bringing up Louis Armstrong.
Please.
He was criticized by many prominent black entertainers at the time for not participating in the march, the civil rights marches of the 60s. Mm-hmm. And this was a very deliberate, conscious decision. And he explained it by saying, I give money to the cause, but I'm not going to march in the street. If someone were to swing, take a swing to my face with a baseball bat and ruin my chops, a trumpet man is finished.
Yeah.
And as Robeson said, my song is my weapon. Armstrong considered his trumpet playing his weapon.
Yeah.
So to protect themselves, I think it was very wise of Armstrong to protect himself. He was asked by a reporter, wait a minute, Mr. Armstrong, you're such a celebrity. Do you really think you'd be beaten if you marched in the street? And he said, they would beat Jesus if he were black and marched.
With the example being, you know, tying this back to Robeson and how being outspoken, you know, he wasn't physically hit with a baseball bat, but I think it's fair to say that his career was.
I can't say it because I don't want the government to come and kill me.
Sure.
But his son, Paul Robeson Jr., who wrote an incredible 2-volume biography of his father, extraordinary, meticulously written. He died a few years ago. He was convinced that his father had been neutralized by the CIA. Mm. He was in Moscow in 1961. It was 3 weeks before the Bay of Pigs invasion, and he was going to be meeting with Fidel Castro coming up. The government definitely did not want him to meet with Castro. And so he was in his Moscow hotel room in the early evening, and he told his assistant that he was going to go to bed early because he wanted to get up early and had things planned for the morning. So the next thing was he was several hours later found in that hotel room bathroom, lying on the floor in a pool of blood. He had slit both of his wrists. Mm. And apparently what happened was there was this big party in his room, which he didn't plan for. He told his assistant he was going to go to bed early.
Sure. Wow.
And so it was at that party that something was put into his drink. And it's thought to be when the government started experimenting with using LSD to neutralize dissidents. And so his son flew to Moscow and started asking all kinds of questions like, what do the blood tests show? What was in his blood?
Yeah.
He couldn't get answers to those questions. And he was found poisoned as well. He was at a dinner and asked for a cup of tea. And he thought the waiter looked strange. And the next thing he knew, he was hallucinating and had him and his father both ended up in a sanitarium outside of Moscow for some time. The son recovered. The father never recovered. He was in and out of mental hospitals and clinics in Russia, in East Germany, in London, in New York City. He was prescribed over 20 different drugs for depression and paranoia, and was given 54 electroshock treatments, which damaged his brain further. The government succeeded. The last 14 years of his life, he was unable to function in public. And he lived at his sister's house in Philadelphia. And his wife had died before him. And his sister cared for him those final 14 years of his life. It's an unbelievable tragedy.
It really is. And it kind of just leaves me feeling an even greater obligation to make sure that, you know, this story is included among the many when we're talking about not just music history, but American history and world history, you know, the ways in which a person who has something to say and uses his art or her art to say that, how they can be quelled by the very government, the very establishments that proclaim and allege to protect us and to have our pursuit of happiness in mind. It's so tragic, and it just underscores for me why Paul Robeson's story is so important.
I can't think of any other figure in history. He was 6'3" and a half, good looking man, And athlete was a professional football player and a professional basketball player. That's how he made money to finance his education at Columbia Law School. So you know, there was this incredible athletic achievement, and these Hollywood movie star looks that he had. And yet he was the smartest guy in the room. And so when you combined his natural talent, his incredible success on stage and film, on recordings, and then when you combine that with his intellect, when you hear some of this hearing and from 1956 when he was dragged in front of the Un-American Activities Committee, he owned that hearing. He took charge of it and owned it. And I think that's why the government was really afraid of him, because he was so brilliant. They had never come across anyone like that. I think today the difference is that, he was alone. You know, this is before Baldwin and Malcolm X and Martin Luther King.
Yeah.
This was a generation before them. And he was really alone. And the NAACP was attacking him. You know, its leader, Walter White. He was really alone, and he was criticized for going too fast and going too strong. And his response was, how much longer do you want to wait?
Yeah.
He refused. So he was alone. And today, that's not the case. Pete Seeger put it beautifully. He said, what's going to change the world is not these big organizations, but lots and lots and lots of tiny organizations making these wonderful small causes. But the aggregate, the accumulation of all of that is what will affect change. So I guess today, now that we're in the middle of what I would like to think is the beginning of a revolution,
mm-hmm.
I'd like to be optimistic about that. A dear friend of mine said, who's older than me, said recently, yeah, well, you know, those protesters in the streets, eventually they're going to get tired and they're going to go home. And then what? So I'd like to be more optimistic. I'd like to think this is only the beginning of this movement. And so the difference between when he was fighting really alone to now, where there's so many grassroots organizations popping up, I think it's I have a lot of optimism. But and hey, I'm just an ally. You know, I consider myself a student of Trilloquy University. I'm trying to play catch up. You know, I've enrolled in my first course is Catch Up 101 at Trilloquy University. So I'm learning.
Well, and I'm learning from you again. You know, as I said earlier, you know, the scholarship that you have really dedicated to this is so impactful. It's really, you know, been another turning point for me. So I really appreciate the work you're doing and helping us all understand and remember how important Paul Robeson was.
But I keep laughing instead of crying. I must keep fighting until I'm dying. And old man Ribbard, he'll just keep rolling along.
Okay, a huge, huge, huge thanks again to Seeger for talking to me. So I'll have his links to his websites and all of his stuff in the description of this and on the Trilloquy website. Scott, before we get into the Trilloquy, you know, I was telling you about the story of Paul Robeson earlier. And, you know, when we talk about cancel culture and all that sort of thing, we think about it as a peer-to-peer thing. But, mm-hmm. you know, here we are with the story of Paul Robeson, and we have the United States trying to cancel a person. You know, those power structures coming down. Do you think, you know, we're going to see more of that? I mean, we saw it with Colin Kaepernick when it comes to the NFL, you know, I mean, with these stories, you know, taking front stage these days, do you think it'll be easier to just identify that sort of thing and call a duck a duck?
Probably if you know, and look at the letter of 150 some odd academics and writers and whatever who are warning against this cancel culture. And again, I think that it's important to differentiate between canceling and calling out.
Yeah.
People are going to call you out day to day, but it's going to be pretty hard to get canceled, don't you think?
I mean, Dell believes that, you know, my time is going to run out at some point. And that's something I've been thinking about, you know.
That you're going to get canceled.
But, or you know, in the negative or the positive, you know, if not social media, you know, something I say cost me my job or whatever, you know.
Okay.
And we saw that with Paul Robeson, you know. So how can we not consider that today? How can we not consider that for what we're doing? When is our time gonna be up and the good old, you know, status quo's come back over to take over?
Mm. My trilloquy for the week, I want to involve you with this, because we were talking about my challenge to a black orchestra saying the first orchestra that announces an all black season wins.
Yeah.
And you were curious about, well, then why don't we do this with radio? Why
sure.
don't we? Okay. Let me tell you some of the things that I'm thinking about in cancel culture and calling out right now. For 30 years, I've been hosting this classical music and not talking about these issues. Mm. And in some instances it's because I didn't know any better. That's not an excuse, but that's what happened. And I see, I listen to the guests talk about the importance of having people of color in positions of power. And for a long time, I was dreaming about trying to help the next generation
by being in one of those positions of power.
Right. Okay, so now I'm trying to square that with myself about, okay, well, is that a job that I should be doing? And then it starts to make me look at the work that I'm doing as a classical music host, how I'm not at every turn talking about the inequities and racism and things that happen, either because I don't know about it or I'm not ready to do it yet. And so I start to question whether or not I should be doing the job, mm. right? And then I'm ineffective as a host. Now, I have to advocate for a process that I know that people of color don't like, which is time. Because on the 4th of July, I talked on a few occasions, not every occasion, which, you know, I'm getting to a point where I'm able to do it. But I'm not going to do it until I'm ready, because it's not going to be genuine then. It's not going to be authentic.
Mm.
And on all of the things where I said things that could be by, like if a person of color was saying this to a white person, they would Karen out or I feel threatened, you know, or
okay.
do one of these things. But I didn't get any emails. So I'm wondering, Garrett, if I'm onto something.
Well,
I'm wondering if me just pointing in directions and just sort of subliminally saying things, if this is not a tactic, if I'm not getting them ready for the real brass tacks conversations.
Something that I've really learned is that what's most important is being heard. You know,
mm.
it doesn't do much good to stand on the mountaintop and scream something that makes total sense and is totally equitable, whatever, you know, whatever. If no one is hearing you, if no one can receive your message, and, you know, it's a slippery slope, because it gets on the conversation of, you know, who, you know, why are we censoring that perspective when it comes to this? But, you know, I've been too resigned to believe that it's more important that a person hears me than, you know, than not. And it's not that, excuse me, it's not that I, you know, I censor myself or wash myself up. I'm just trying to make sure that people understand what I'm saying. I think that's what's important. So, you know, as that applies to you, I think that's fine. But I do have to say, you know, we can pull up all of the quotes from the great thinkers, black thinkers of days past, decades past. But, you know, that idea of time is just one that I just cannot stand behind, because, listen, because it's fine if white folks need time to kind of figure things out and settle in. That does not mean black folks also need time. We can be in these positions of power making these changes and making the world more equitable while y'all figure out how to fit into that. I don't think that's a part of it for me.
Okay, so then it has to be a part of it for me then.
And that's fine, and that's totally fine. But a person in a position of power should not be someone who needs time to sort of think and adjust. That has to be someone who is there.
Okay, so then what would your response be to me saying, you know what, I'm worried about being canceled? What would you say to me? Because if I'm questioning the job that I wanted, and I'm not talking about being in the spotlight. I'm talking about finding voices and giving them a microphone and helping them to shape a sound.
So go ahead.
And for me to listen to the interviews that happen on this podcast and not have this conversation with myself, then I would be dumb, right?
Yeah.
So how can I advocate for the end of my own job?
And this brings me to my trilloquy. So earlier this week, Del and I got into a conversation of, allyship, absolute allyship with parameters, and the weird sort of tangent. I'll go ahead and tell this story. The weird sort of tangent we got on was the idea, looping back to we're actually talking about Louis Farrakhan Morris, because he's been in the news and all that for what he's always in the news for. But one of the things that he advocated for, especially back in the early 90s, was this separate, self-sustaining black state, okay, where black people can live, happily and equitably and in peace and all that sort of thing. So, what Del was talking about, for folks who don't know, Del is my boyfriend who is half white. And, he was talking about, does his support for that lead to his living in this separate white world in which he has to deal with the folks that, he's always tried to, fight against and avoid and X, Y, and Z. And that just got us on the conversation of, okay, so is that the limit of your allyship? Can you be an ally and a supporter of black liberation up to the point of it actually costing you something, and we went on with that conversation, but I think that applies to what you're saying, right? So
yeah,
you're discovering and trying to figure out what are the limitations, what are the parameters of your being an ally. That's 100%.
What it sounds like. 100%.
And on that, I think, when we get done taping, we've planned on watching the movie Django. So next week, I'm going to get your opinions on that, since you've never seen it. But there's a scene early in the movie where the main white character tells Jamie Foxx, Django, the main black character, how much he hates the institution of slavery and racism and all that stuff. But understanding their places in that world, he's going to take advantage of that to help both of them, to mutually help both of them. So, and there's big discussions that can happen there. But I don't know. I think that, what we all have to discover and explore in our own way when it comes to all oppressive systems is what role we're playing in it, what position of power or unpower we have in it, and how we can use that position to help break it down. If that's what we're going for, I've just kind of wrote something down earlier today. Being an ally has to come with the acknowledgement of past and present complicity in the systems that oppress those with whom you consider yourself that ally. So, basically, for me, one of the first steps is saying, okay, look, I am a part of this, racist structure. I'm a part of the patriarchy. I'm a part of whatever. This is a position I hold. Do I have parameters of my allyship? What are those parameters, and what do I need to do to move beyond those, to erase those, and to really make my allyship absolute. And this is, you know, an ongoing conversation, you know, that's very nuanced when you throw in the idea of intersectionality, you know, so supporting Black and queer people, you know, supporting Black women specifically, you know, as who Malcolm X acknowledged the most oppressed in America, you know, the Black woman. So, you know, I think you're on a journey, Scott, that many people do not go on. And we've said over and over again on this podcast and off the podcast, real change is not comfortable. Real change is not something that, you know, feels good. And the more we engage some of those unfeel goody moments with ourselves, I think the more genuine the work is. I mean, do you not see that?
I do see that. But you see, the thing is that when I listen to the guests, when I hear someone like Sister Soulja, who is a very familiar voice in my teens and 20s, when I hear her say, the good white person will cede power, and to 25 years later have it ring true is, number one, embarrassing, but number two, to have the realization to go, okay, Garrett, I'm questioning even my role in this podcast, in this platform, because this is a form of power,
yeah,
right? And am I a stumbling block, or am I detracting from the real work? And then I have the part of me that's saying, well, you know what? Men voted for women to be able to vote. So why can't I play that role to be talking to other white people like me so that they're ready for a Black person like you and not feeling like they're being attacked or torn down or whatever?
Well, I think we have to acknowledge in that analogy you made, you know, men may have voted for women for the right to vote, but, you know, think about all of the blood, sweat, and tears that those, you know, women put in.
I understand.
Those suffrages,
I'm trying to justify my position in it.
Sure.
And so, I you can back me up here. On four occasions, I've come to you and said, are you sure that I should be doing this podcast with you?
Well, who else is going to do all the Ableton stuff?
And Evan.
Okay. Well, listen, I appreciate your work, you know, and for those of you listening, you know, I would ask you, you know, especially those of you who are not Black, you know, what privileges do you have? What positions of power do you have? And how can you, A, use that, you know, to lift up and work toward the liberation of Black people, A, or B, you know, if you can't do that, how can you secede that power to someone who can mm-hmm. do that? You know, I think it's a very important question for all of us to ask ourselves. What if being an ally means being in a position of no power? Would that be enough for you? Would that be a stumbling block? Are you an absolute ally? You know, and I think if the answer to that is no, I think it's an honest answer that, you know, lays the pathwork for, you know, actual, you know, something.
It really is an amazing time because I think the pandemic started it, but then George Floyd's murder probably compounded it. That a lot of people are finding out that their spot in the caste system isn't what it was.
Right.
Like that their station isn't quite as good as they thought mm-hmm. they had it before. And so the sound that you're hearing is the realization of this cognitive dissonance by white folks all over the country.
I also feel like I'm hearing the sound of a refrigerator or something.
You had to bring it up, didn't you?
That means it's time for us to wrap up. Yeah, thank you for listening. Arrest the cops who killed Breonna Taylor. See y'all next time.